Ho, ho, ho. We're in December now, and for this review, I'm going to talk about a movie that is Christmas-related, but not in the way you'd expect. I mean, the movie I'm going to talk about today, the movies Silent Night, Deadly Night, and Bad Santa are about 100 times more Christmassy than this movie, but at the same time, it is technically a Christmas film. Less Than Zero, from 1987. Now, before I talk about Less Than Zero, I gotta talk about the author of the book that it's based on, Bret Easton Ellis. And this is the book, Less Than Zero. For those who don't know, Bret Easton Ellis is the author of the extremely controversial novel American Psycho that was later adapted into the well-known film starring Christian Bale. Before his Dark Knight days. And Bret Easton Ellis, I really have loved the novels he's written, and there was a time a few years ago when I used to like to read, and I haven't really been into reading books for a few years now. But back when I was really into reading, Ellis's novels were some of the last things that I really fully read. And it was because of the movies based on his books. After I saw American Psycho, I wanted to check out the novel because I heard it was even more graphic and grisly than the film. And I really loved the book, and then I decided I'd watch the other movies and then read the books that they were based on. And Less Than Zero was Bret Easton Ellis' very first novel. It was published when he was 21 years old, I think. And it is, I mean, it's nowhere near as intense as American Psycho, but Less Than Zero, this is quite a debut novel for a guy, and it features some of the most disturbing, nightmare-inducing things you could imagine. Bret Easton Ellis' books involve things such as sadistic torture, murder, rape, all forms of rape, date rape, pedophilia, and heavy drug use. And the main thing with Ellis's books is that the main characters in every novel are either depressed, horrible, or just people who do not give a shit about anything. Narcissism is his main trademark, and his books also are known to not have really a coherent plot. They're more just a bunch of events in the lives of the main character that the book is focusing on. And it's kind of like real life, as if the main character, who is always narrating the story as you read it, allowed everybody to come into their life for a few months. And Less Than Zero is one of the most incoherent stories you could read. It's very interesting. It has a lot of, you get absorbed in what you're reading, and a lot of it doesn't really go anywhere, but at the same time, all the different chapters, when you're reading them, it just fascinates you. I mean, it fascinated me, and probably did to tons of other people. It's the story, I guess, of a young college kid named Clay, who comes from a very wealthy family, and that's another theme of Ellis's books. The main characters from the books I've read are always very wealthy, or they come from wealthy families. So, yeah, not a lot of people can relate to these characters, but nonetheless, very interesting to watch. And the character Clay, he comes home from college, and it's established that he goes to a fake college in New Hampshire. And he comes home to California for the Christmas season to be with his family and reconnect with old friends. And in the book, he ends up staying in California for 2 months just because it's hard to explain, but he's in that space of mind where a young person doesn't really know what they're going to do with their life, and they don't really have any plans to go forward with any, and they don't have any real plans to do anything. They just kind of go with the flow, or just drift. Maybe that sounds stupid, but that's the best way I could describe it, because, once again, the book doesn't really have a coherent plot. And by the end of the book, the character Clay, who's been through a lot by the end of the story and seen a lot of things, most of them horrible or just sad, he really hasn't changed. And the character Clay in the book is not, I guess you could say, a horrible person. He's just a person who, as I said, doesn't give a shit. Because he sees a bunch of his friends do awful, terrible things, but he does nothing to stop them, and he witnesses a very close friend of his being forced into prostitution, and he doesn't do anything to change it. He just stands there as an observer. Yeah, I think that's the best way to describe Clay in the book. He's an observer of things as he goes through life and doesn't really take action or do much. But by the end, he just goes home and doesn't really try to make anything of the relationships he has back in California, and it's unclear where he'll go. In the next novel that Ellis wrote, The Rules of Attraction, which some people may know, it was adapted into a film in the year 2002, directed by Roger Avery, the Oscar-winning co-writer of Pulp Fiction, and it starred James Van Der Beek, who I believe was either in the last few seasons of Dawson's Creek or the show had just wrapped up. I'm not sure, I've never watched Dawson's Creek. I'm pretty sure a lot of young people this day and age, like in high school, have not seen or probably heard of that show. I'm not exactly a book person, so it's real hard to describe, but I do love this novel, and I love the other novels I've read by Bret Easton Ellis, and Ellis is a very, aside from his books, he's a whole batch of controversy on his own. If anyone remembers, in 2012, he made some pretty not okay Twitter remarks, I guess, about Catherine Bigelow, I think, the director of The Hurt Locker, saying she only got where she is because she's a hot woman, and not the most awful, horrible things, but definitely a real jerk thing to say. And I remember when I read what he said on Twitter, I thought, I just quoted Jackie Brown and said, "What happened to you, man? Your ass used to be beautiful." I'm not sure if Ellis has really mellowed out, because I haven't really kept up with him. But I do know that he said that after the whole Twitter controversy, that he knew what it felt like, I guess, to be put upon, and I came out as a gay man. And his sexuality had actually been something that people wondered about for years, because a lot of the main characters in his books are either bisexual or gay, or it's hinted that they may be gay, but they haven't come to grips with it yet. In fact, the character Clay in the book is bisexual. It's never really elaborated on, but there is a scene where he goes with a male model to his apartment or condo. It's been a while since I read the book. He spends the night with them, and although the chapter doesn't go into graphic details, it's implied that they had sex. And Clay mentions in his narration that it was a nice night. I don't know exactly what to say about Bret Easton Ellis other than He seems complicated, like a lot of people. And he says that the main characters in his books, in some way, are a reflection of where he is at the time that he writes the book. And the books are usually very bleak or depressing, or just very dark-humored. So I'm not exactly sure what to make of the guy himself. And I just want to mention before I forget, I might have started mentioning it, then I lost track, but the character Clay appeared in Bret Easton Ellis' next novel, The Rules of Attraction, which takes place at the fictional college in New Hampshire that Clay is coming home from. And The Rules of Attraction, unlike Lesson Zero and American Psycho, is narrated by many characters. Primarily three, Sean, Lauren, and Paul. And occasional chapters are narrated by a minor character or a special appearance character. One chapter is narrated by Clay, who mentions characters from Less Than Zero. Ellis's books have a way of connecting. They're not full sequels to each other, but they do have a way of connecting. The biggest one would be Rules of Attraction and American Psycho. Because the main character in Rules of Attraction and the main character in American Psycho are brothers, Sean Bateman and Patrick Bateman. And I really need to get to the movie. The movie Less Than Zero, it is virtually nothing like the book. As far as adaptations go, the movie Less Than Zero is a horrible adaptation. But at the same time, I think it is an incredible fucking film. And I think a lot of that is owed to the fact that I saw the movie first and then read the novel instead of reading the book first, because I'm a huge Harry Potter fan, and the books, my mom read the books to me when I was little, and then I started reading them on my own around middle school. And I went to see all the new movies as they were coming out in the theaters. And I love the Harry Potter movies, but Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, the movie, that was just a lousy transition from book to film, and it just made me think it's better just to watch the movie first, then read the book. So that way, when I see the movie, it won't disappoint. And Less Than Zero, I'm going to give the rating ahead of time. This movie gets 9.7 stars from me, baby. This film is just, it is an 80s movie like no other. As many have said, it totally feels like a time capsule of the 80s, and I hate to say something that others have said, but best way to put it, and the whole thing is just covered in the 80s. You see 80s fashion, you hear 80s slang, you see 80s technology, those old cassette players, TVs, the big blocky TVs, and the soundtrack. Oh my god, the soundtrack. The soundtrack for Less Than Zero is just bliss. The songs they use are perfect, and they go with the mood of whatever scene they're supposed to go with, and the songs themselves are able to set up moments that are very disturbing, and with the song it doesn't particularly match the situation, but the song manages to help increase the levels of uncomfortableness. Like Quentin Tarantino, and Quentin Tarantino, from what I've read, Bret Easton Ellis said that Tarantino, apparently, I'm pretty sure this is not gonna happen now. I mean, it's been talked about, but there's been no hints that it'll ever happen. But Ellis said that Tarantino was maybe considering directing a remake of Less Than Zero, and I forgot earlier, but I just remembered. My uncle sent me a link to this interview that Bret Easton Ellis did with Quentin Tarantino, so I guess I have kept up just a little bit, even if I didn't realize it, with Ellis, and it's a pretty awesome interview. I don't remember what it's called, but it's Bret Easton Ellis interviewing Quentin Tarantino this year, 2015. I say check it out. As for how this movie differs from the novel, oh, it differs greatly. I mean, this movie is maybe 98% different than the book. Maybe I'm overstating it, but there's very little from the book in it. And it's completely a different thing. There actually is a story in this movie, and in this movie, the character Clay is more of a normal but still rich white kid who's going to college, and I guess he has some idea of what he wants to do with his life. But at the same time, I guess he believes in romance. Oh, and Clay is played by Andrew McCarthy, who 1 year after this would do Weekend at Bernie's, and his girlfriend, who is named Blair, is played by Jamie Gertz. When I saw this movie, I had not seen anything but Twister. And just to shock you, Twister is one of my favorite movies of all time. Dusty Man, the Dust Man. And Andrew McCarthy, he gives a very good performance. Plays kind of a, not a complete idiot. Like, his character, Clay, he's by no means stupid, just get the feeling he has no idea what real life is like, such as the idea of that there are bad people in the world, and he'd like things to go a certain way. He loves Blair, but it's young love, and how many relationships of that age really work out? And his best friend is named Julian, played by Robert Downey Jr. And Robert Downey Jr. was 22 when he made Less Than Zero, I think. And before this, he had done Weird Science and the Rodney Dangerfield movie Back to School. And even though Andrew McCarthy and his character are supposed to be the main character of the film, and he's supposed to be the star, Robert Downey Jr. just blows him out of the water. He steals the whole fucking film. The movie pretty much becomes about his character, Julian. And as for the plot, the film opens with the characters Clay, Blair, and Julian graduating high school. And I'll be very clear on this. I have not finished high school. And I have never been to a high school graduation, so I don't know how exactly one goes down, but it's complicated in my case, and I don't particularly want to go into it. Just, I'll say this, I've had a lot of stress issues and a lot of personal struggles, and I feel that's where I'll leave it at. But back to the high school graduation that suddenly made me iffy. When these characters graduate high school, we see them passing around champagne bottles, and we see that they're drinking it right from the bottle, and yeah, a lot of kids like to drink when they celebrate or party, but they're drinking whatever they're drinking at the high school after they've graduated, and I don't know, I mean, sure, kids are celebrating, but they're still only like 18 or 17, and would they really be allowed to do this? I mean, there's people taking pictures, there's still teachers around. I'm not saying this is a bad thing, but just, it's questioning, and Clay, Blair, and Julian, we see, are the best of friends, and Clay and Blair really care about each other, and they think they're really in love, but when you're a teenager, anything can happen. And Julian seems like the best friend someone could have. And then this opening scene fades to black, and we see a text that says 6 months later. And we see Clay at college in New Hampshire. It's never verified, but that's what's in the book. And Clay gets a phone call from Blair asking if she'll see him. And he's not sure. And he sits on his bed, and we see in his mind flashbacks to when he was last in California. And there's this very depressing music playing, which doesn't match up to the cheery opening we just saw. And we see in the flashbacks that Blair was gonna go to college with Clay, and then she backed out at the last minute because, in her own words, "I just don't want to." And because I'm afraid to. It's not exactly that clear of an answer, but I understand that people can be really scared going to college. I had a friend who backed out of going to college because it was too stressful. Wow, I'm having a lot of intense memories. And Clay goes to college and tells Julian to look after Blair. And as Clay sits in his bed at college, he looks like he's gonna cry, and we cut back to his flashback, where we see that he went back to California for Thanksgiving, and he walked in on Julian and Blair in bed. And as he prepares to go back home, he sits there not sure what he's gonna do when he gets there, and he's not sure, I guess, at this point, now that the things that meant the most to him in his life have pretty much almost forgot I had these. And when Clay gets home, we hear this pretty cool song by the Bangles. And it's a pretty mood-shifting song that has a dark opening and then has kind of an upbeat but still not completely positive feel to it. And Clay gets home and he finds some letters in his bedroom in California. And going through it, he finds an invitation from a high school friend inviting him to a Christmas party. And it says, when he opens it, "Let's fuck Christmas together." Funny line, and just that there, I feel, is the main thing that really makes it somewhat a Christmas movie. And Clay goes to this pretty extravagant Christmas party. I mean, it's unclear if it's a nightclub that he's going to or if it's his rich friend's house, but god damn, this place he goes to is fucking huge. I mean, we see that the whole place is full of giant, those big giant box TVs. Like, we have huge TV sets that make up gateways and doorways. The place looks like it's the size of a fucking high school. And we see bedrooms, and many bedrooms, huge-ass bedrooms, and the walls have been decorated Christmas style. I mean, the whole place looks like it's been painted Christmas style. And there's graphic drawings of people having sex, and there's, like, ice outside. It's California, so that must have been expensive. There's a pool. I mean, there's ice around the pool for people to skate on. Waiters, buffets. I'm just wondering, is this the girl's family's house? Is this like a condo? Is it a club? I mean, I'm just curious, because I don't know, this is her house, It must have cost like a quarter, half, or half a million dollars just to have it remade in that winter style. It's just, I'm like, Rules of Attraction, the movie and the book, don't have the most realistic feel to it, and that's kind of the thing of Ellis's work. It's all very surreal. But there's some things that'll just make you go, what? Yeah, a lot of movies will make you go, what? But this moment was the biggest what moment for me. And when Clay arrives, he goes to meet Blair, and it's a pretty awkward and emotional reunion. Blair feels, as she should, guilty over what she did. And Clay, in some way, it would be questionable why, but apparently in some way, he still loves her, but at the same time, neither of them are sure just what they're supposed to do now. Blair kind of wants to reconnect, but she's scared that it won't happen, and Clay, he's not sure if it'll work, or even if he wants to, but part of him just feels still connected to her. I just need to mention this fact. I haven't been able to spot him, but according to IMDb, Brad Pitt had one of his earliest jobs working on Less Than Zero. He was an extra during some of the party scenes, and from what I read in IMDb, his salary was allegedly just $38. I'll gotta start somewhere. And while at the party, Clay bumps into an old acquaintance played by James Spader. And Spader, who is known as one of the best villain actors today, I believe this was probably the movie that showed that he could play a very scary character. Spader's character, Rip, is a drug dealer for all the rich kids, and apparently he used to deal to Clay, and at one point they might have been friends, and in the novel, the character Rip is there, and he and Clay are friends, and in the novel, Clay is a heavy cocaine user, and in the movie, it's implied that he used to do drugs, and he just doesn't do it anymore because he's not interested, or he outgrew it, and drug use and drug addiction are a huge part of the movie. It's also in the novel, but in the film, it's more focused on. And so why they changed the character Clay from being a non-user, I'm guessing the studio might have been afraid that it would have made Clay hard to like. But the character Rip, played by James Spader, and I'll get into Robert Downey Jr. in a second, but the character Rip, this character next to Downey's character Julian is probably the next best thing in the movie. The character comes off like a friendly dealer, sweet-talking you, trying to make you feel comfortable. But as the film goes on, we see Rip's true colors. The character Julian, played by Robert Downey Jr., he is very troubled and very messed up. He has a loving father, played by Nicholas Pryor, who did all he could to get Julian a very well-paying job at the beginning of the film, and it's a little questionable about the dad, because he does say at his high school graduation, "I never thought we'd get this far." So the dad might be a little, I don't know, just questionable in the way that parents can have high expectations of their kids, and in the months since Clay, Julian, and Blair graduated high school, we see that Julian is pretty desperate for money, and the reason why, he has become addicted to crack cocaine, and he owes the character Rip $50,000. And Julian is trying to make some kind of a business happen so he can pay off his debts. And we also find that he is pretty much homeless at this point, and that his family has abandoned him, either because they're embarrassed by what he's doing, or, as Julian's father says to him in one scene, you live your life the way you want to, but not here. Watching Less Than Zero after Robert Downey Jr. went through his struggles with drug addiction and all the trouble that he went through, watching Less Than Zero is kind of eerie, because, yeah, Robert Downey Jr. plays a hopeless drug addict, and I'm not going to say Downey was like this character exactly, because he got better, and he came back. But the scenes where his character, we see him going through his addiction, and scenes where he's going through withdrawal, and the scenes where he smokes crack, which are very intense, it's hard not to wonder, was this what it was like for Robert Downey Jr. when he was using drugs? And was it worse than what this movie shows? And the movie Less Than Zero, the scenes of characters doing drugs are very well done, and I've never used cocaine or heroin or any heavy drugs, but I do sort of know what it's like to withdraw from something, because I used to take medication for some of my anxiety, like antidepressants, and the way my body works as far as brain chemicals go, I don't know the exact term because I'm not a doctor, but the way my body works and my head works, I can't take antidepressants, and when I did take them, it actually made me worse, and it then took about 2 years to completely stop taking the meds and get it all out of my system. And it's nothing like what happens in Less Than Zero, but I can sort of understand. I mean, the scenes in Less Than Zero, the scenes in Less Than Zero with Robert Downey's character going through withdrawal, these scenes, I am pretty sure, are what showed to the world just what an amazing actor Robert Downey is. He really goes all the way for these scenes in showing this character at a really tragic point. He's shaking, sweating, he throws up many times, and at one point he's pretty much covered in his own vomit. It's heartbreaking to watch, and once again, knowing everything that Robert Downey Jr. went through himself in real life, it's scary to think that this probably has been him at one point. And for those who have seen the movie, and this is the spoiler area, so you knew what you were getting into if you decided to continue to watch it. At the very end of the film, Clay and Blair do their best to save Julian. They stayed with him through his withdrawal, and They're pretty much giving their lives to him to save him. And when James Spader comes after them and tries to hurt Robert Downey, they take him out of California, and just as they're out of the state, I think, or on the edge of getting out, somewhere in the desert, Julian dies. And it's such a sad scene. But the thing is, not every addict can be saved. The film feels very realistic in these scenes, and Robert Downey Jr., I think he should have been nominated for Less Than Zero. And before I go back, when Robert Downey Jr. was on Inside the Actor's Studio with James Lipton, he commented on Less Than Zero saying, "I wound up living the part for 8 years." Yeah, the whole thing is just ironic. And I said eerie. The scenes of Clay, Blair, and Julian interacting are very well done, well executed, and a great filmmaking area of Less Than Zero is the camera, cinematography, and lighting. Next to the music and the songs setting up some very unnerving and surreal scenes, the lighting caught me, that is, especially in the scene of Julian, Clay, and Blair in a restaurant after they reunite at the Christmas party, and the camera's at a low angle and the lighting is kind of dark. It makes the whole scene even more uncomfortable than it already is. And even though it's not a major thing, something that's funny to point out is in the scene where Clay and Julian reunite at the Christmas party, Julian is wearing eyeliner. Pretty cool. Once again, the 1980s. Nothing wrong with looking pretty. Take note, Doug Walker. Oh, and I should have mentioned this when I was holding up the book, but I read that Less Than Zero is Brad Jones' favorite novel. Fucking A, man. The characters Clay and Blair, as the film goes on and Clay begins to see what Julian is going through and what he's become pretty much, and Blair, it's established, has been going through it with Julian, seeing him go through these horrible situations and helping him through it as best she can. It's a movie where, outside of the three main characters, everyone else is either pretty uncaring or just too retarded to know any better. Like, some scenes that show that these characters feel kind of alone in their lives outside of their interactions with each other is many friend characters of Clay, Julian, and Blair from high school who have a lot of scenes in the book and are in many scenes of the movie, but they aren't the main focus. We see these friends, and most of them are girls, and they're the, I guess, stereotypical airhead cocaine sniffers. And the character Blair herself sniffs cocaine, and she doesn't come off like an addict. Maybe Blair doesn't have the addictive gene that some people have. And Jamie Gertz, by the way, her performance has often been criticized, but I think she does a good job. I mean, the character is a little uneven, but I think that's more owed to maybe some questionable writing. But she does a terrific job, I think, and she plays a troubled young woman. She and her character is a bitch at times and doesn't think things through, and but at the same time she cares. She cares a lot about Julian, and at the same time she's not very responsible. Like a lot of the all the characters in this movie, she's complex. And as I said, the friend characters, they don't really think that much. Like, they think even less than the main characters do. Like, I know Blair, as I said, doesn't particularly think that much about life. Or she's afraid to. But her friends just, yeah, a lot of young people do this. They don't really think about life that much. Which can give the impression that they're idiots. There's a scene where a friend of Blair, who's another heavy coke user, her nose starts bleeding because she's been snorting too much cocaine. And taking a tissue, she says with a really retarded grin, "Rusty pipes." And in the Rules of Attraction, the movie version, when Jessica Biel's character is snorting cocaine, she snorts so much that her nose begins to bleed, and I guess as a tribute to Less Than Zero, she says, "Rusty pipes." And there's a scene where Blair goes to visit her father, and it's about a day or two, I think, before Christmas happens, and she goes to his house, puts a present on the table, and knocks on his bedroom door. And he says, he doesn't come out at all, we don't see Blair's father. And he says, "That's nice, sweetie. You gonna stay?" "No? Okay, I'll see you in a day or so." Sounds like the real tough-sounding rich daddy who gets his daughter everything, but doesn't spend any time with her. I think we might know where the Sweet Life of Zack and Cody got the inspiration for the character London Tipton's father. Yeah, I watched that show when I was 10. But it's an interesting scene, and Blair says she'll see him, and as she's about to leave, the door opens and a young woman who looks like she's maybe 10, 12 years older than Blair comes out and says hi and smiles, and she's not wearing pants and she's wiping the side of her mouth, which implies she's been sucking the dad's cock, and she says to I'm just mentioning this because it says a lot about the scene. And she says to Blair, "Sorry we couldn't spend time with you." And this brief moment says a lot, because the dad then calls out for his girlfriend, and she goes back in, and Blair looks like she's not happy about the whole situation. Just implies a lot of loneliness. And Clay and Blair, they do eventually rekindle their romance, but it's still on rocky waters, and Julian, who's smoking up crack on a very daily basis and is desperately trying to find money to pay off Rip, he keeps showing up in their lives, and they try to ignore him just to be with each other, but the fact of the matter is they're all connected, and even if they can't stand him, they do still care about him. Clay asks Julian what's going on, and Julian, being stubborn, doesn't answer what he's asking him, and just acts like he can handle it on his own. There's this funny but uncomfortable scene. I know there's a lot, but this is really uncomfortable and kind of funny, where Clay goes to Julian and Julian tells him he's going to make a comeback. Clay, who's not very confident in the whole idea, says, "Great." Then Julian says, with a Marlboro light in his mouth, "They'll sneak in your bedroom and steal Blair from you, and this will just go on for years." Clay keeps his smile and says, "What?" It's hard to describe in what I'm hoping will be an hour-long video, but eventually Julian's plans just fall through, and he tells Clay that he needs $50,000, and Clay says, "Where do you expect me to get that kind of money?" And asks Julian, more like a concerned parent than a friend, "What are you going to do when you pay? Are you going to get better, go to rehab? Are you going to continue?" And Julian just says, drenched in sweat and looking as desperate as anybody could possibly get, "I don't need a discussion on the finer points of morality. Just spare me!" And the scene that follows this has Julian breaking into Clay's house and meeting Clay's little sister, who looks like she's maybe 7 or 9, maybe 6 or 8, somewhere around that age range. And Julian starts saying, "You don't call, you don't leave a note. I hate to say it, but I think you're not taking this relationship seriously." And Clay's sister is trying on her mother's jewelry, and she thinks he's just being funny. And this scene is very intense, because Julian is in such a fucked up place that you wonder, what's he gonna do, and is he gonna do anything to her? And at one point, he's talking to her like she's a non-committed girlfriend, and the whole scene's very unnerving, because he's so messed up at this point, you wonder, could he do something sexual to her? Would he? Luckily, it doesn't go that route. But at this point, he's just in a very dangerous place. I feel like I need to get this going, because there is something I really want to do for this video. The only other main character who I will talk about is Rip, played by James Spader. And Bret Easton Ellis, when this movie came out, since it's such a horrible adaptation of his novel, he fucking hated it. But years later, he's sort of come to appreciate it, and says that Robert Downey Jr. and James Spader's performances, he loves it. And James Spader in this, as I mentioned earlier, he starts out as a friendly guy who would make you think you can trust him. And when Spader has to be, he can be really terrifying. Because in his early scenes, he's smiling and comes off as just a friendly guy. I'll stop saying that, but in his later scenes, he forces Julian, while still putting on a nice guy persona, Rip forces Julian into being a male prostitute, and get the feeling this might not be the first time Julian has had to do this stuff to make a living, and seeing the character Julian go through this stuff, I guess what makes the character Julian, because he's not, I guess, likable, but he is extremely sympathetic. And when Clay tries to save Julian, Julian just doesn't know what to do. When Clay says he could bring him with him to the college in New Hampshire, Julian just yells at him, "Do I look like I'm ready for homework?" The character Rip, he is evil, and he doesn't do as many horrible things as he does in the novel, but at the same time, because in the novel, the character Clay, the character Rip is just fucking evil. And he doesn't do as many horrible things as he does in the novel, but in the film, he has pretty much no redeeming qualities. And the novel, even though he does worse things in the novel than he does in the film, in the novel, he is able to be friends with Clay, and this may seem odd, but to give people an idea of just how disturbing the novel was, I mean, the movie is very disturbing, and to anyone who thinks that the movie was too polished to match the tone of the book, this movie is depressing, disturbing, and extremely well done, and it will probably make some people cry. Everyone has their opinions, but that's mine. But at the same time, this movie, the movie Less Than Zero is disturbing on the level of, say, Martin Scorsese's Taxi Driver. And the book ups that level of disturbingness by maybe 50 to 100 times as much. And to give you an idea about the novel and the character Rip, I'm going to read to you a brief chapter. When we get to Rip's apartment on Wilshire, he leads us into the bedroom. There's a naked girl, really young and pretty, lying on the mattress. Her legs are spread and tied to the bedpost, and her arms are tied above her head. Her cunt is all rashed and looks dry, and I can see that it's been shaved. She keeps moaning and murmuring words and moving her head from side to side, her eyes half closed. Someone's put a lot of makeup on her, clumsily, and she keeps licking her lips. Her tongue drags slowly, repeatedly, across them. Spin kneels by the bed and picks up a syringe and whispers something into her ear. The girl doesn't open her eyes. Spin digs the syringe into her arm. I just stare. Trent says, "Wow." Rip says something. She's 12. "And she is tight, man," Spin laughs. "Who is she?" I ask. "Her name is Chandra, and she goes to Corvallis," is all Rip says. Ross is playing Centipede in the living room, and the sound of the video game carries to where we're standing. Spin puts a tape on and then takes off his shirt and then his jeans. He has a hard-on and he pushes it at the girl's lips and then looks over at us. "You can watch if you want." I leave the room. Rip follows me. Why? Is all I ask Rip. What? Why, Rip? Rip looks confused. Why that? You mean in there? I try to nod. Why not? What the hell? Oh God, Rip, come on, she's 11. 12, Rip corrects. Yeah, 12, I say, thinking about it for a moment. Hey, don't look at me like I'm some sort of scumbag or something. I'm not. My voice trails off. It's what? Rip wants to know. I don't think it's right. What's right? If you want something, you have the right to take it. If you want to do something, you have the right to do it. I lean up against the wall. I can hear Spin moaning in the bedroom and the sound of a hand slapping maybe a face. But you don't need anything. You have everything, I tell him. Rip looks at me. No, I don't. What? No, I don't. There's a pause, and then I ask, oh shit, Rip, what don't you have? I don't have anything to lose. Rip turns away and walks back into the bedroom. I look in, and Trent's already unbuttoning his shirt, staring at Spin, who's straddling the girl's head. Come on, Trent, I say. Let's get out of here. He looks over at me and then at Spin and the girl and says, I think I'm gonna stay. I just stand there. Spin turns his head while he's thrusting into the girl's head and says, shut the door if you're gonna stay. Okay? You should stay, Trent says. I close the door and walk away and through the living room where Ross is still playing Centipede. I got the high score, he says. He notices that I'm leaving and asks, hey, where are you going? I don't say anything. I bet you're gonna check out that body again, right? I close the door behind me. Some people probably stopped watching this video while I was reading this chapter, and I completely understand if they did. That is a very disturbing and one of the most disturbing things I ever read in a book. And you want to know what is really fucked up? That chapter that I just read is just an appetizer for the disturbing things that Bret Easton Ellis has written, and like I said, his writing is very interesting and can pull you in, and I recommend his books. But yeah, the movie does not reach that level of disturbing, and as I said, what I just read to you is an appetizer for the rest of Ellis's work, pretty much. And the movie itself is probably 1/10 of just that chapter. And the last thing I'll say about James Spader in Less Than Zero is his final scene features one of the best lines in the movie, where he yells at Clay and Blair, who have tried to take Julian out of Rip's influence. You don't have a fucking clue what you're getting yourself into! And then he says something else. And then he says, and this is the line, everyone is accountable! And he says it with just a great evil glare. So I feel I've talked as much as I could without having to make this its own miniseries. And in the end, I love Less Than Zero. I think it is a great film. It is a horrible adaptation, but it's a great fucking film. I recommend seeing the movie first, and then reading the book. And the book itself is a wonderful fucking book. Just another thing I have in common with Brad Jones, and it's an incredible ride, and I don't know if it's a trip or a nightmare. This is probably not the first thing you would think of as far as a movie about Christmas, but the next movie I'm going to talk about will be more Christmassy. I hope everyone's having a good December.